Demon exists, but you don't need to be afraid of them. Nithya guys, welcome you all with my love and respects and the divine blessings of my guru, his divine holiness, Bhagwan Sri Nityananda Paramashiva. Today's video, I want to share myth-busting clarity about rakshasas, asuras, demons, negative energies. Do they exist, yes or no? Yes. So the understanding I got about what is a demon, a demon is nothing but the manifestation, a being which decides to cherish a life negative cognition intensely. And because he is intense, he will manifest a certain amount of power and he will be able to exist and become an embodiment of that life negative cognition. But you don't have to be afraid of that. And I'll share why. I'm trying to think what example I can give. Life negative cognitions such as hard power. People who want to have power, they have the power hungry, power hunger. Power hunger is a life negative cognition because that kind of cherishing the desire to have power is, power happens automatically when you radiate the space of responsibilism. So seeking responsibilism should be the where the seeking should go towards. It should not go towards how I can get more power. Because power is a side effect of buddhi. When you have the right cognition, when you have the right inner space, automatically power manifests. Of course, when Swamiji gives the power of science of power manifestation, that's different. That's for us to play with the powers so that we can grasp the right inner space, so that we can fully establish ourselves in that inner space. The space is the purpose. The power is a side effect. The power is not the purpose. The space from which the power emerges, radiates, is the purpose. Because that is the space of oneness. Because Swamiji initiates into shaktis, not siddhis. And I'll maybe talk about this in another video. But in this video, you don't need to be afraid of demons and asuras. Why? Because all life negative cognitions is based on powerlessness. When you do not, when you still have any form of threat or fear of death, threat towards your existence, that you feel that you cannot exist. Let's see, for example, you will see some people, they go in front of crowds, they collapse. They don't feel they can exist in front of the pressure of having a crowd in front of them. Some people feel they can't exist if they don't have the good food they want. Some people feel they can't exist if they don't have somebody to talk to. Some people feel they can't exist if they don't have their own space. Some people feel they can't exist if they don't have, you know, music and lights and parties. And some people think they can't exist without cigarette, alcohol, drugs. Some people think they can't exist without, you know, so many luxurious items and being in a comfortable environment. So many people are, we can be threatened. Our existence can be threatened by so many things. And the purpose is identify where you feel the threat and complete that and stop feeling threatened and just realize that you are the pure consciousness, that you are Paramashiva, the space of Paramashivoham. So, but demons, when they, rakshasas, asuras, they operate from a space where they are intense. They have a certain level of integrity, which allows them to access a certain level of intensity, but their intensity is oriented towards a life negative cognition. So they will start to radiate powers, but they will do evil things with it. They will not enrich people. They will control, manipulate, destroy, bring people down. All these life negative frequencies, lower frequencies, I should say, lower frequency. A demon is just a low manifestation of a low frequency. So why we don't need to be afraid of them? Because they don't have completion in their inner space. So at some point, when they are in a certain space, they can be alive and radiate their power and their demonic energy, whatever. But then they collapse themselves because they don't have full ownership of their own inner space. So their powerlessness catches up to them. And once it does, you know, it's, you see in the Puranas and all that, all the great demons, they'll all be sleeping like crazy. They'll be lustful. They'll be jealous. They'll be engaged in very low frequency stuff. And the moment they are in these, when they're assailed by these low frequency desires of sleep or food and all that, then they lose power over everything. A good example I wanted to share with that is the story of Bhasmasura and Shiva. So Shiva is there radiating Paramashivam in Kailash, and Bhasmasura is an intense being, but unfortunately a demon, means he's focusing on life negative cognitions and he's not interested in completing with some of his patterns. And so he radiates something and he manifests the space where he gets a boon from Paramashiva. Shiva is Bholenath. He's the innocent, completely innocent, but so powerful. Bhasmasura gets the boon from Shiva that whomever he touches will be turned into ashes. So Bhasmasura suddenly feels so empowered. He's like, great, I have this boon. I am invincible now. Nobody can do anything. Anybody I don't want, I can just discard them and turn them into ashes. So Shiva is there. He's like, okay, great, you get the boon. And the people around him, Devi, Ganesha, and Subramanya or other, they're like a little bit shaken. Same thing that happened with Ravana when he asked for the golden city. So anyways, so he gives the boon and then... And then Bhasmasura goes on rampage. He just starts to run around and just destroy people, puts hands in, and then suddenly he just feels like, hey. Then he runs after Shiva and he wants to destroy Shiva. Because he's powerless. Maybe I'll have to explain why in another video, why he, that space of powerlessness, why you want to do it. See, when you don't have the Paramashivoham experience, Shiva is a threat to you. Because he's more powerful than you. And you don't understand the space from which he operates. So that is why taking responsibility and getting established into the space of Paramashivam is the most important thing, because that's the only thing which is beyond everything. So anyways, he's not in that space. He runs after Shiva. He tries to destroy him. Shiva just plays the game. He knows he cannot be touched. He's Bholenath, means he's innocent, but he's so powerful. You cannot conquer Shiva. Shiva is not conquerable. That's why I feel they say in the scriptures, Ekam, he's the one. Swamiji says it's not about being one, it's the space of oneness. But Shiva is the embodiment of the space of oneness. He is the one because he is established in the space of oneness with everything. But the space of oneness is the reality. It is not one. Because many of the other things, then we get into duality. If there's one, then there's two, then conflict. And so all this is not there. It's the space of oneness. And if he is the one, he is the one who is in the space of oneness. So anybody who is in the space of oneness is the one. So anyways, so that is why oneness with the Guru is important. But anyways, back to the story, guys. I'm ranting here. Bhasmasura runs around. Shiva pretends like he's scared. He runs around. He hides. Then Vishnu is like, then the devas are crying like, hey, somebody stop this, stop this. Then somehow Vishnu gets called and he comes. And if I'm not mistaken, he takes the form of Mohini, a feminine form. Then Bhasmasura's lust gets awakened and he gets enchanted by this beautiful form of Mohini, and somehow she convinces him to touch him in the head, or she says, like, I don't remember, but she convinces him to touch himself on the head. So he touches himself on the head and he turns himself into ashes and he's gone. So that's just to say that an asura is not in control. When you have power and you don't have the right inner space, it is dangerous. It is dangerous because at some point, the moment you fall in your blind spot, you will use that power against you. And then, like we see in that Bhasmasura's blind spot got awakened by Mohini, and like that, she got him to turn himself into ashes. I used to play a lot of video games, and for me, I can relate something like, see, if you seek power, even if you get it, you won't know how to use it if you're not in the right space. If you're given power without being in the right space, it is dangerous. If you play a game and you have the possibility, I used to play video games, and anyways, that's the past. But you could equip an axe, you could equip a sword or a mace or a bow. You have different kind of equipments. But for you to be able to equip it, you need to go through the training. Even if I purchase the sword from the merchant, and then I have the sword in my inventory, I won't be able to wear it. Why? Because I didn't go through the sword mastery, the sword training. If you don't know how to use a sword, you having a sword is useless. If you don't have the right space to manifest the power, you having the power is useless. So it's all about the space. Then you have to go through the sword training, you get trained, and then you equip the sword and you know how to use the sword. If you take the sword without the equipment, chances are the sword will land on your head and then you will land on the ground, and then your soul will go back to the cosmos because you would have left the body. So that's what I wanted to share today. So you don't need to be afraid about that. But we need to be aware that some people are in that space. And when we see that space, we should not engage with it because there's no need. But the fear should not be there. Just simple awareness and simple decision not to support life negative cognitions, to go towards the master, to cherish the desire to experience oneness with the guru so that we can experience the space of oneness, Paramashivoham, the space that Shiva embodies. So with this, guys, I'll see you guys in the next episode of MythBusting. Nityananda.
I welcome you all with my love and respect. Let you all open all your three eyes. Om Nithya.